another diary. Carl felt like someone was trying to communicate with him. Or was it simply the result of happenstance? A fire can't be started with a snap of the fingers. Right until that point, Carl had believed that the object of this crossbow hunting had been a ravenous wolf who was terrorizing the village. But as he noticed the height at which the bolts had been fired, he concluded that the beast had to have been as tall as a man on his feet, not unlike a gorilla. The thought was chilling. Carl had found what he was looking for. He needed to get back on the road. The door was unlocked. Carl felt kind of disappointed that he wouldn't have to solve the mystery of that padlock. Carl reckoned that the place was still inhabited less than 24 hours ago. His detective sense tingled, revealing to him, or was it the strong smell of wilderness in the air, that there were most likely two men. The jacket was still soaking wet. The poor man had, surely unwillingly, had a taste of the pond's water not too long ago. According to the pay stub, that poor man was Alexandre Blais. There should be a rifle hanging there. Its owner may not be very far. Two blankets. There were doubtless two people here, Carl reckoned. Carl wondered how long he would have to endure this skin-stinging cold. This hunt was never ending. Carl hoped that the hunter had finally triumphed over the beast. Seems like this place was long deserted. Just one more move for Black to checkmate White. The flames won't grow without some help. Other materials were required. The door had been busted down violently, and a burnt smell filled the air. Half of the cabin had been consumed by flames. Carl surveyed the chaotic scene, noticing that someone appeared to have intended to use the furniture as bonfire fuel. Carl had no idea how such a mess could have occurred, but he knew it didn't bode well. Two more victims of this ice plague. Carl felt a chill down his spine. What if he was next? Felt the strong pull of a vision overcome him. It looked like a simple hunting accident. There was Hamilton. Carl recognized him. A major hunting accident. The doctor examined the young woman. Death couldn't be overturned. She was dead. It was not the type of body you buried in a big ceremony in the village graveyard. It had to be hidden. No one could know about this. The best way to do that was to have a simple-minded man bury the poor girl, Lamotte, the mechanic. The doctor denied the unfair death of the young woman, but Hamilton had him in his grip. Hamilton knew all of the poet's secrets and wouldn't hesitate to reveal them. I know all about your crimes, you little communist. You know mine. What a sordid affair. Understood the ins and outs of the affair. A woman had been killed in an unfair accident, and a young warrior had damned himself to avenge her. But Hamilton, the one responsible, had already been killed, and so the beast could not quench its thirst for vengeance. And now, recklessly, Carl had pulled the bolt from the beast's heart. A beast who was but a young Cree man lost without his fiancée, and who had, out of hatred, become Wendigo. Thank you. after him, but for how long? Disappeared, so did purity. I would defend purity against the winds, the tides, against ice and blizzard. Could it be that all this was but a story of justice and vengeance? The soulful doctor, avenging his fiancée's unjust death by avenging this young woman as though she was his lover. Are these passionate feelings not precisely the kind of feelings that could cause a storm, petrify people deep inside, create monsters?
Un survivant! On a trouvé un survivant!